The Accountant General of the Federation, Ahmed Idris, has stated that the £4.2 million looted by a former governor of Delta State, James Ibori, which the federal government recently repatriated from the United Kingdom, had been returned to the Delta State. This move is, however, contrary to the earlier position of the Minister of Justice and Attorney General of the Federation, Abubakar Malami SAN, who recently stated that the state could not benefit from the recovered loot. He said Delta was not captured in the agreement signed with the British government, which was a precondition for the release of the money. Well, joining me to discuss this is Eugene Abels. He's the director of Extra Step Initiative. Thank you very much for joining us, Eugene.
Yes, good evening. Thanks for having me.
Now, of course, you and I know that there's been an imbroglio between, a back and forth between the Delta State government and the federal government as to who deserves this money and, you know, who doesn't. The federal government under the Attorney General had vehemently refused that that money comes to Delta State because they said they had an agreement of sorts with the British government. Now, the first question that I would ask is, at any point during the times that monies were being recovered or there was a rumor that the then governor had looted funds, did the Delta State government ever admit to the fact that they were missing funds? Did you hear of anything like that?
No, they never did. For political exigency, that would mean committing harakiri. They never did, and they never will say the funds are missing.
So why? What's the local standing for the Delta State government asking for that money to be repatriated to them?
Well, that's just been the precedent, whether it be Bayelsa, whether it be Benue State, for political exigencies. Don't forget that for a long time it was just a one-party thing that was in charge, so there was no way they were going to say anything that would make their political parties look bad. But they expect the federal government, which had camped the present administration, like the last one, which had claimed, which had promised to help recover stolen funds, and they expect them to do the dirty work. And after they've done it, they naturally will seek for the law to be applied. So it will come to them. They just sit back and watch.
Now, the Accountant General of the Federation, Abubakar Malami, had said that the money was not going to come to Delta State. He said it again and again. But then the state's accountant general, I heard her on the radio talking this morning, and she said that the money has not been deposited in the Delta State government account, even though the accountant general has said that monies had been deposited. In fact, when he was speaking to the House committee, he said that those monies had been sent to the state. But the state is saying they had not taken receipt of that money. In fact, that woman said authoritatively that she was not sure what account the money was deposited into. So it makes me really wonder, is she implying that the federal government is not being truthful about where the money is?
Well, while you were speaking, when you were introducing the topic, there was a very important dimension you introduced when you were quoting the Attorney General. You said the Attorney General said that Delta State cannot benefit from it because they were not party to that conversation and the agreements. Mm-hmm. Now, what this simply, it opens up an angle that Nigeria, the federal government, led by the Attorney General, understanding that when such funds come, since they are not revenue, they must go back to the owner of the funds, which is the people, the various ethnic nationalities that make up Niger and Delta State. Now, if knowing that a precedence has been set with Benue and Bayelsa State, that it will have been very proper that those meetings they went for, particularly at the point of signing, that the Attorney General of Delta State, who represents the various ethnic nationalities of Delta State, will have been taken along so that they are aware and they are party to all of it. Now, if the federal government comes further to say, look, we pursued this matter, we've incurred X and X cost, so you must pay for us doing this job, I'll bear the administrative expense. I will understand that it makes sense. But we know that the funds are not that of the federal government, so they must go back to Delta State, whether they do or they do not do. It's like the derivation thing, it's like the federal allocation thing. So now coming to the next part of it, whereby now the Accountant General said that the funds are used, the Delta State Attorney General is saying that they have not received them. I think they should give it some time. Eventually, if the monies are not released, they'll go to court and seek for their rights to be enforced. There's no need to, they just need to be vigilant, but they don't need to quarrel over it.
I mean, we're just talking about the Constitution and obedience to the law and, you know, the loopholes that our Constitution, you know, has, in the first segment. And it brings us back to that issue where some laws are adhered to and sometimes modus operandi is jettisoned totally. Like you said, if this was the format that was followed for other states, why is Bayelsa State different? Could it be that the federal government is trying to single out Bayelsa State to make an example of them? Again, if this is what the Constitution or this is what the law, the rule is, how come a representative from the state was not included in that particular group of people who were going to get that money? Why were they also not included when they were taking receipt of that money? Does this not mean that the federal government has no plans? Because again, at that same forum where the Accountant General was saying monies would be sent to Delta State, the Attorney General again insisted. So these are two people representing the federal government taking two different stands. Will that money ever get to Delta State?
It will. It will. Leave. What you're saying is politics. And I think that it has, and the disagreements in public space of representatives of the government has become, it's become a usual occurrence. Remember the issue about the clearance of the former Magun, the former EFCC chairman, where agencies under the same government came out to indict somebody. This could have been done quietly so that we see one, it's one government, one president, one manager of the legal system, one judiciary. So this kind of thing send conflicting signals. That makes us not to look serious before the eyes of the international community. And within our polity, it sends mixed signals and gets people a bit confused. Now you see all the uproar about this. There shouldn't be any. There's no big deal in it. Monies were supposedly freighted out of a state because those who were entitled constitutionally to ensure that such things are checked didn't do their job, which is the Delta State House of Assembly. They didn't even blow the whistle. Nobody made any complaint. So it was federal government and the federal government agencies which found out that such and such funds, when they were alerted by foreign government that these funds are out there. So now that you know the money is there, but due to political exigencies, Delta State has gone mute until the money is ready now or the soup is ready to be cooked. But whether you like how they have behaved or how they have carried on, the constitution must take precedence over it. And I expect and hope that the chief law officer will do that, which a precedence has been established for. If it is revenue, all forms of revenue must go to the Federation account. This is not revenue. This is funds already belonging to a state. So it must go back. You cannot post it any other place. It will come into the central bank and through the central bank, and it will go to the other, even if it takes 10 years. There will be no need. But if, you know, in all of this, if public officers know that their jobs are not personal, that it's a duty which is transient, and that you could be sanctioned for it, people will not make certain utterances in the public space. People will be a bit careful. I think as a nation, we're acting like adolescents. When I was growing up, this wouldn't have happened. Growing up, what we're seeing now wouldn't have happened. It is not the standard. This is not how Nigeria used to be, or how we grew up to know it to be. And today I'm in my 50s, and I've worked in several places, and I don't think it's the standard. It's wrong. It's wrong for two principal officers to say what should be done. The Attorney General can say what he has. Not that the money has come in. entire jurisdiction and management of those funds belongs to the accountant general, and he will do that which is right within the confines of the law. If the law says that the funds must go to the federal government, fine, they show justification. But it would be wonderful if we finally, why don't we even go to the Supreme Court and test it so that this matter will be laid to rest and become responsible by setting up a clear protocol on how we can manage and receive funds that are frittered abroad, public funds that are stolen. I think that's the way to go. Not for us to be here and washing our linens in public. It does not make us look good as a nation at this such an old age.
Finally, before I let you go, this is something that states ought to learn from, because whether we like it or not, lootings are still going on. Funds are being taken from states and not accounted for. Nigerians have continuously asked that there be some form of accountability. But every time they ask, of course, it falls on deaf ears. And then at the end of the day, when these monies are looted into other countries, or, you know, we have to now repatriate them. What should states, other states, be learning from? Should we wait for this to happen again for us to be able to learn from it? Or should people be whistleblowing early enough so that it's nipped in the bud?
There's nothing to learn. It's already written there. If you remember that in Rivers State, there's a perpetual injunction restraining the EFCC from investigating state accounts within the law. So the responsibility of ensuring that funds of public funds within a state and local government lies entirely at the purview of the Houses of Assembly. But because they are appointed, so they cannot live up to their responsibility. But I do not blame them, nor blame the political class. I blame me and you, who are the public, who have refused to do that which we're supposed to do.
Does the judiciary not share in that blame? Because you also said that in River State, there is a perpetual injunction for the EFCC not to investigate any public office holder. So the judiciary also shares in this blame, because how do you give a perpetual injunction as against to what the Constitution has said?
Unlike the way it is made to sound, let's even follow it the way it makes. Who has anybody, including the FCC, gone to court to vacate that order? We're yet to see that almost 10 years down the line. The court cannot give you what you do not ask for. People must go and seek to vacate it. Yes, either the EFCC or other public interest group might make to challenge that aspect, that order, in court. The Nigerian Bar Association is there, but they're not doing what they're supposed to do. They have these large jamborees, which they do annually. All lawyers gather and enjoy themselves. But they are there, and they did not tell us, for instance, that you did not need a certificate to run for president, unlike what they were selling us. So all of these lacunas and loopholes exist in the Constitution, which I expect the Nigerian Bar Association should have been educating people. Yes, we know they keep some of these things as secrets to enable them. How come the political class and the people at every election, they come up to say things that create loopholes in our electoral system, in our laws? Now, even the judgments that have been taken, there's this agreed silence. For instance, that of Imo State, where evidence was taken from an employee of INEC instead of the regulator. And everybody's quiet, including Nigerian Bar Association. If we keep allowing these things to happen, then whatever we see that we accept, we will take it.
Okay. Yes,
because right now, those who are employed are determining what we eat, and when it's supposed to be the other way around. Find out what the likes of what we did in the 80s, the Bekor and some Kutis and the Gani Dem and so on. What we did between, even Baba and Bubu himself experienced a bit of us in 1984, 85, when he came into power. It was led by girls and women. But at my age now, I can't be leading that. I'll be talking. We need to go beyond Twitter and begin to make effective demand on the system to change things.
Okay.
If we wait for those who are appointed, nothing is going to change in the country.
We need to go. We're out of time. Thank you very much, Eugene Abels, for being part of this conversation.
Thank you for always looking lovely and giving us time. Lovely.
All right. Okay, well, this is all the time that we have on Plus Politics. We want to thank all our guests for being part of the conversation, and we will see you tomorrow as, of course, Governor Donald Duke has gone back to the PDP. We'll talk about it tomorrow on Plus Politics. I'm Marianne O'Connor. Have a good evening.